She was an attractive military mom, driven to succeed.
Exondia was a beautiful woman. She had a successful career.
He was a handsome Navy man who turned heads everywhere he went.
Manny had that something. He was exotic.
And nowhere was their romance hotter than in the bedroom.
She literally wrote out a menu of sexual favors done to you and for you.
Some of the sexual things that they would do, they were like porn stars.
But when one of them suddenly vanished, skeletons came tumbling out of the closet.
This couple, they had a lot of secrets.
One of the most shocking things that we found was actually a document, and it gave very graphic and detailed information on butchering the human carcass for human consumption.
I think it defies humanity. It's disgusting.
You will never believe like something like this will happen. You see only stuff like this in movies.
The person committing this crime is someone who's just completely and thoroughly evil.
October 2007. Oklahoma City police have received word that 33-year-old Manny Salado is missing.
Detective Garrett.
The beloved husband and father has not been seen in days, and concern is mounting.
Manuel Salado. Got it, we'll get right on it, thanks.
We made several attempts to contact him on his phone, which were not successful, so we ended up going over to the home.
When officers arrive at the apartment Manny shares with his wife, Exondia, they are taken aback by the condition of the place.
The entire apartment was disheveled.
There were clothes everywhere and trash and other miscellaneous items just scattered across the floor. When I first arrived, it didn't necessarily look like a crime had occurred. It just appeared like someone was in a real big hurry to leave the apartment. There were clothes everywhere, furniture was missing. The entire place just looked like it had almost been ransacked.
Police aren't sure what they have on their hands, but one thing is clear. Manny is nowhere to be found.
Did something happen to Manny, or did he just leave?
Why hasn't he made contact with his family? His family members have already said that absolutely he would never go this long without communicating with them.
Moving from room to room, investigators find what they believe to be signs of a struggle.
We saw several stains on the wall, which appeared to possibly be blood. We thought, whoa, we might have something here.
There was some on the front door threshold, the front door, and then there were two bedrooms, and there were what looked like blood spatter.
They found blood, and at that point, the case moved from a missing persons case to a possible homicide case.
Is Manny Salado alive or dead?
This was a man who came to work on time every day and was in his child's life, and he just up and disappeared.
Right off the bat, it's a mystery. Well, where's Manny?
Raised by a single mom in the island nation of the Dominican Republic, Manny Salado worked hard from a young age in order to support his family.
We argue like every brothers do, but he was protective and he was the man of the family.
When Manny was 17, he and his family emigrated to America in search of a better life.
When we first came to the United States, it was to New York, and he was the only one that graduated from high school.
After graduation, Manny enlisted in the military.
He wanted to leave the house, go to the Navy, because he wanted to go out there, explore.
But when Manny was off duty, much of his exploration was focused on the opposite sex.
My brother used to have a lot of girlfriends before. Very pretty, but he wanted real love with a really nice person.
While stationed in Norfolk, Virginia, Manny ventured into a local nightclub where a young African-American woman caught his eye. Tall, dark, and drop-dead gorgeous, 30-year-old Exondia Lynx was a standout in any crowd.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. What's your name?
I'm Manny. What's your name?
I'm Exondia.
Exondia was very exotic looking. Her eyes were captivating, a very beautiful woman.
It was clear from the get-go that Exondia thought Manny was pretty easy on the eyes as well.
Exondia liked to go out. She loved going to the clubs particularly. She was the life of the party, very fun-loving. And the night that she met Manny, she had actually gone to the club with some girlfriends. And she saw Manny. You know, Manny's handsome, and she just thought he was exotic. And of course, he liked her too. He thought she was pretty, liked her skin. He called her La Morena, which means American black girl. He thought she was hot, and he liked her because she was intelligent and well-spoken. So they really hit it off in the beginning of the relationship.
Manny soon discovered that Exondia's good looks were accompanied by some mind-blowing moves in the bedroom.
Manny Salado came from a traditional home. When he met Exondia, she was different from what he was used to. She liked to experiment in the bedroom, and I think this is something that excited him.
She showed him things sexually that he had not seen before. He wasn't used to a woman who was so free sexually. This was something that was very strange, but very exciting to Manny.
She literally wrote out a menu where you could go to certain rooms and have various types of sexual favors done to you and for you.
But Manny and Exondia's connection ran much deeper than just sex. Like Manny, Exondia had joined the military after high school.
She was an avionics technician, computer expert. People who worked with her say that she was very well respected. She was intelligent. She knew her job.
Sadly, Exondia's military career had been cut short.
She got discharged from the Navy early, I believe, because she had some illness, I believe, anemia.
Following her discharge, Exondia had struggled to support herself and her two children from a previous marriage. But instead of being put out by Exondia's children, Manny saw them as another opportunity for he and Exondia to strengthen their bond.
He really tried with Exondia's children. He tried to be that father, you know. He tried to treat them as if they were his children.
This whirlwind romance quickly took off, and they ended up being married.
They were just really happy. They really did sort of mesh together and become a really solid family.
In 2002, Manny and Exondia welcomed the birth of their first child together, a beautiful baby girl. Manny couldn't have been happier.
He used to bathe her, comb her hair, anything that she needed, he had for her.
In 2006, 4 years into their marriage, Manny left the Navy. He and Exondia moved to Oklahoma City, where Manny joined the Army Reserve. From the moment they arrived, Manny and Exondia knew this is where they wanted to spend the rest of their lives.
They were able to find a cozy two-bedroom apartment in a suburban area in Oklahoma City. Exondia was able to stay at home and be a doting mother and wife. The family was very excited about starting a new life.
But the couple's life together would take a disturbing turn on October 8th, 2007, when Manny mysteriously disappeared.
We can't find Manny. No one knows where this man is. But they know that something happened to him because the blood in the apartment.
The investigators have to find Manny, whether he's actually left or if he's deceased.
But as the search for this devoted husband and father unfolds, a new picture of Manny and Exondia's relationship begins to emerge. One that looks less like a fairy tale and more like a nightmare.
That's when they realized that this couple had a lot of secrets. And those secrets have everything to do with the disappearance of Manny.
Manny and Exondia Salado seem to have it all. A passionate romance, loving children, and a promising future.
They had a great marriage. They had three lovely children.
The family was very excited about starting a new life in Oklahoma City.
But in the fall of 2007, the couple's dreams were put on hold when Manny suddenly vanished.
Manny basically disappeared off the face of the earth. A loving father, had several friends, even though he was new to Oklahoma City, and he just vanished.
Neither friends nor family hear from Manny for days, and a missing persons report is filed on him. Police search the Salado's apartment and find it in a state of disarray.
Once we received information about what was going on, we drove over to the apartment where Manny and his wife lived. When we entered the apartment, things were everywhere.
There were clothes everywhere, furniture was missing. The entire place just looked like it had almost been ransacked.
Not only is the apartment a mess, but there appears to be bloodstains on the wall.
Before we entered the apartment, we noticed a few possible blood spatter stains on the front porch. And once we entered the apartment, we saw some additional blood spatter by the front door, and also we saw some in a bedroom closet.
As police search the apartment, Exondia arrives on the scene.
I let her know that I was trying to locate Manny, and she went into a few details about their relationship, the marriage, and the fact that he leaves and wanders off all the time and that he returns whenever he wants, and all I would have to do is call him on his cell phone and that would take care of
him. Okay, he can tell you where he's going.
No, but he does that sometimes.
Manny's behavior seems odd for a couple that appear to be so madly in love. But Exondia explains that Manny isn't really in love with her anymore.
Manny was from the Dominican Republic, and Exondia claimed he'd gone back for a wedding, had met a woman there, and fallen in love with her.
When Manny met her, she was the maid of honor for my wedding. They got together and they was getting along. He liked her a lot. They danced a lot, and they talk a lot. So I was the one that made the connection happen.
According to Exondia, the other woman's name is Isabella. When Manny returned to the States, he and Isabella did everything they could to maintain the long-distance love connection they established in the Dominican.
They talk through chat, they talk through instant messenger, they talk through email. He's telling her how much he loves her and how much he misses her.
While Manny did his best to hide his new relationship, Exondia claims she knew he was up to something and went so far as to spy on him to prove it.
Exondia needs to find out the truth. So what does she do? She decides to use her computer skills. She buys the spyware to hack his computer to find out exactly what he's doing.
Exondia tells investigators that Manny hasn't really vanished. He's just in the Dominican for a rendezvous with Isabella. Exondia's story seems plausible, and her body language suggests she's telling the truth. But what about the blood-like stains found on the walls? Investigators question Exondia about them and the general chaos of the apartment.
What can you tell me about this?
I'm just moving some things out.
It looks like a tornado went through this apartment.
We spotted what looks like blood right there on the doorpost.
Did something bad happen to Manny in this apartment?
No.
Exondia tells them the stains aren't blood, and she remains adamant that Manny is in the Dominican with his new lover. But as they collect samples of the blood-like substance, detectives are beginning to doubt Exondia is telling the truth. But forensic analysis of the stains adds credence to her statement.
None of those stains tested positive for blood. There was absolutely no blood evidence inside their apartment.
In fact, CSIs are unable to make any substantive match to the stains on the wall, which lends even more credibility to the theory that Manny has run off to be with his Dominican mistress.
They couldn't prove that he had actually been murdered. And in fact, he had motive to flee. The woman in the Dominican Republic professed her love for Manny, and he did the same to her.
It seems Exondia is telling the truth. So detectives turn to the Dominican government to help track down Manny.
We had his family looking, and we also made contact with the Dominican consulate in DC. We checked his passport, and the passport hadn't been used for him to exit the country.
We even had the U.S. Marshals Service help us, and there was not a trace of Manny.
Unable to find Manny, U.S. Marshals help investigators track down his Dominican girlfriend, Isabella. But she seems equally in the dark about Manny's disappearance.
Isabella hasn't heard from him. Isabella is wondering what has happened to him, too. So if his sole purpose was to leave Exondia to go back to the Dominican Republic, then why hasn't he made contact with Isabella?
So if Manny isn't in the Dominican and the scene inside his and Exondia's apartment isn't related to his disappearance, what happened to him? Detectives decide to widen the circle of friends and family they want to interview. In doing so, they quickly discover another case of infidelity. Only this time, it's not Manny who's been doing the cheating.
Looks like Exondia was having an affair of her own.
During an investigation, we found that Exondia had a boyfriend in Chicago who she kept in close contact with.
Exondia had an affair with Edgar Garcia. This was someone that she actually had met prior to meeting Manny. And then the relationship rekindled after her and Manny were married.
Exondia was bored with Manny. She's tired of Manny. She wants to be with her lover in Chicago.
He would email her houses that were on the market that they could live in Chicago.
But for all of Edgar and Exondia's talk of being together in Chicago, investigators can find no sign that Exondia ever initiated divorce proceedings against Manny. Is it possible Edgar Garcia took it upon himself to remove Manny from the equation?
Hello?
That's the question investigators ask him point blank.
Edgar starts getting these phone calls from the cops. They're asking him all kinds of questions. He doesn't want to answer them.
It's like pulling teeth. Basically had to pull everything out of him we could.
I don't know what you're talking about.
I didn't see anything. I don't even know the guy.
Though Edgar's not the most forthcoming suspect ever, there's nothing that concretely ties him to any crime.
I certainly had certain impressions based upon the evidence that we had, but there was no direct evidence that he was involved in the case.
With the investigation foundering, detectives turned to the person who initially filed the missing persons report on Manny, a woman by the name of April Stubbs.
April Stubbs and Exondia were in the Navy together. They became close friends, always maintained contact as the years went on. When they moved to Oklahoma City, they didn't know anybody here other than April Stubbs and her husband.
But what April Stubbs tells police will throw the investigation into chaos and ultimately reveal a tale of carnage even the most seasoned investigators hadn't seen coming.
We went crazy, like, whoa, what's going on here with this girl? It was messed up.
It's disgusting. The details are very graphic, and it was very premeditated and very planned.
Detectives in Oklahoma City are on a desperate search to locate missing reservist Manny Salado. So far, the investigation hasn't revealed Manny's whereabouts, but it has unearthed some skeletons in Manny's closet and in that of his wife, Exondia.
In Oklahoma, they had a lot of problems and the marriage started falling apart.
There was infidelity and he developed a relationship with a woman in the Dominican Republic. Exondia had a relationship with an individual from Chicago.
And even though Exondia had a lover on the side, when she found out about Manny's newfound love, she went to great lengths to keep tabs on her wayward husband.
Exondia had installed spy software on Manny's computer that would take a screenshot every 3 minutes.
But despite this tangled web of adultery and jealousy, it seems neither Exondia nor her lover, Edgar Garcia, nor even Manny's girlfriend in the Dominican had any clue about what happened to Manny.
There is no evidence to suggest that they were involved in this. They were just absolutely in shock.
Unsure where to turn, detectives reach out to April Stubbs, a friend of Manny and Exondia's, and the woman who filed the initial missing persons report.
Just want to ask you a few questions. Maybe you can help us clear up a few things.
Manny and Exondia knew April for a long time, so of course they've shared secrets.
According to April, Exondia and Manny's fairy tale romance started to deteriorate almost the moment they moved to Oklahoma City.
Exondia became unhappy, and I think it was the fact that he was no longer financially stable. He wasn't working, he was out of the military, and I think the financial setbacks caused a lot of problems in their relationship.
She's buying anything she can buy. She's furnishing the house. She's buying designer clothing. And people who knew her said that she was sort of like that. She liked to show off a little bit. She liked to show off her nice clothes. And she used to tell people, well, I don't have to work. You know, my husband takes care of me. So that's sort of the fantasy world that she lived in her mind. And she wanted that to really be true. So she's able to do that for a little while until the money is gone. And they're back to being broke.
April claims that with Manny no longer bringing home the bacon, Exondia started punishing him in other ways.
She would withhold sex from Manny. She began to lash out at Manny and emasculate him in multiple ways, as far as not being the provider that he was before.
It wasn't long afterward that both Manny and Exondia struck up relationships outside the marriage.
It's gonna be very difficult for a couple to be able to maintain a relationship if they don't trust each other, because they're looking over their shoulders, they're looking over their back.
April tells investigators that a couple days before Manny's reported disappearance, Exondia contacted her and asked if April would help her move out of the apartment she shared with Manny. But when April arrived, Manny was nowhere to be found.
So where's Manny? I haven't seen him all day. Oh,
he's in the closet.
It was a strange statement, but April brushed it off. Until a few days later, when things got even stranger.
Exondia shows up at her apartment, and she asks April to babysit her daughter.
Bye, baby. Mommy loves you. Okay. April, I won't be gone long, all right?
Bye. Come on, you ready to go in?
According to April, Exondia didn't return in a few hours like she promised. Rather, it was 3 days before Exondia came back to pick up her daughter. When she did, April was stunned by her appearance.
April Stubbs says she's wearing muddy boots, camouflage clothing, and she has this really foul odor that April can't describe.
Where the hell have you been?
April, I'm sorry. Okay.
Why are you covered in mud?
I had to drop off my package.
When Exondia told her this bizarre story, she immediately contacts police and files a missing persons report for Manny.
They made April suspicious. She figured she had to say something.
April's story is enough to give detectives the ammunition they need to conduct an even more extensive search of Exondia's vehicle and apartment. Warrant in hand, detectives ask Exondia to leave the scene so as not to interfere with their work. CSIs take photographs to document the disarray, and another sample of the blood-like substance is collected from the apartment walls.
We were there processing the apartment about 8 hours or so.
Once again, the mysterious red stains along the walls test negative for blood or any other organic fluid. But in other areas of the apartment, investigators make some intriguing discoveries.
In the living room, we did notice the rear seat or the third seat of the minivan was actually in the living room on the floor. In one of the bedrooms, we located several personal belongings belonging to Manny, which included his wallet, his driver's license, military ID, shaving kit.
In the apartment, they found all of Manny's personal belongings, identification card, military ID card, his cell phone, all of his clothes.
All the personal belongings that any normal person wouldn't even leave behind if we were going out to run an errand for 5 or 10 minutes were left in the apartment.
And that was the same phone which Exondia told me to call him on. Once we realized that, we knew that there was more to the story.
Detectives also discover a computer. They collect it and send it to the crime lab for analysis.
Everything that's on a computer can actually be backtracked, and you can find it once the research is done.
While the contents of the computer are being analyzed, detectives turn their attention to Exondia's vehicle. On the carpet under one of the rear seats, they again discover what appears to be a blood stain.
The analysis of the carpet from the van was necessary so we could compare it with some samples that we received of Manny's DNA.
As detectives wait for results on the DNA test, they receive a call from the department's forensics unit. They've completed examining Manny and Exondia's computer, and what they found is mind-blowing.
These weren't the type of searches that may be found on a normal person's computer.
In Oklahoma City, a case that started out as a routine missing persons report may be morphing into something far more horrible.
Exondia's best friend called the police and said that she was concerned that Exondia had done something to Manny.
April described her as being very dirty, mud-covered boots, and a very unkept appearance. And the friend said there was just a horrific odor about her that she'd never smelled anything like that before.
A subsequent search of Exondia's home and vehicle has also produced evidence that may help bring detectives one step closer to finding Manny. But it is the blood-like substance found in Exondia's car that is the most troubling.
They couldn't say exactly what kind of substance it was, so they sent it to a lab.
As they await the results of a third round of DNA testing from the crime lab, detectives receive a major break in the case. A forensics team has recovered a treasure trove of information from the Salado's home computer.
If you want to look into a person's soul, you go straight for their home computer. It will tell you everything from their tax returns all the way to their sexual preferences.
Ironically, the spyware Exondia had installed on the computer in order to catch Manny cheating also kept a record of her online activity as well.
When they looked at the spyware that she had actually installed, they could see not only Manny's conversations, but her searches.
She either forgot it was running or was perhaps too lazy to turn it off, thinking that no one would ever go into her computer and find these things. The software was designed to record keystrokes and also take screenshots every 2 minutes.
As detectives review the data from Exondia's web searches, they uncover a disturbing trend.
They find that she had been searching for some really strange things. Chest wounds, head wounds, how to murder someone quickly.
And they were things that you wouldn't find on a normal computer, things such as dungeons and asphyxiation, kidnapping, hold hostage, death by suffocation, murder.
How to soundproof a room, knockout drops, things of that nature. There were so many more. There were hundreds of searches that were damaging. In terms of Exondia, there was absolutely nothing good found on the computers.
Just days before Manny's disappearance, Exondia performed her most disturbing web search of all.
She starts searching on the internet for ways to cut up a body. And then she wants to know how to cook it. How to cook a body.
A person has to be extremely demented to even think about, first of all, killing their husband. Second of all, dismembering them. And then third of all, to barbecue them. Something is really wrong with that.
One of the most shocking things that we found was a text file called barbecuerecipe.txt. This file, when we opened it up, gave a very graphic and detailed list of, quote, butchering the human carcass for human consumption. It went so far as to detail body preparation, hanging, bleeding, beheading, the skinning and the gutting, removing the arms, halving, quartering, all of the things that you would expect a butcher to do with a cow. And we found this actually on the desktop of her computer, so we assume that it was accessed very recently or it was accessed often.
I just find it baffling that she would be able to cut this man's body up. I mean, this is your husband. This is the man that you have made love to. You've had a child with him, and you can actually sit there and physically cut up his body, put it on a grill, and then barbecue it? I mean, did she eat it? It makes you ask that question. Did you eat the parts? What happened to it? And why did she do it? What kind of person does that take? It's just unimaginable to me.
Detectives are horrified by what these searches may mean. Is it really possible that Exondia killed Manny and cooked him?
One of the searches that Exondia had performed was for a barbecue pit for a large animal. And upon looking into this search, there were some items on that list that were needed to build this pen, including chicken wire and cinder blocks.
Cross-referencing Exondia's disturbing internet history with the items collected from inside the apartment, investigators make another discovery, a receipt from Home Depot.
Exondia purchased the materials to build a pig roasting pit, 30 cinder blocks, rebar, chicken wire.
The things she bought at Home Depot are important because in an article they say in order to cook a pig, to make a pit, you need cinder blocks, tin, and chicken wire.
Detectives head to the store in hopes of confirming Exondia's purchase.
We found a employee of Home Depot who had befriended Exondia on a shopping trip.
This employee remembered her and said that he loaded the materials for her into her van and asked what kind of project she was doing. She said, "I can't tell you, but thank you for helping me."
As horrifying as the thought is, detectives now believe that Exondia may have burned Manny in a makeshift barbecue pit. But the million-dollar question is, where did this unthinkable crime take place?
Nobody really knows what happened to him after that. We can't find the man.
It's been several weeks since 33-year-old Manny Salado vanished without a trace.
Manny leaving his family is completely out of character. Even though he and Exondia had problems, he wouldn't have left his daughter so abruptly.
Now, a search history recovered from Exondia and Manny's home computer has detectives pondering a terrifying new theory.
It showed all the planning stages of taking another human life, from gunshot wounds to blunt force trauma to blood spatter.
One of the most shocking things that I found on her computer was a text file. It was called barbecuerecipe.txt, and it gave very graphic, detailed information on, quote, butchering the human carcass for human consumption.
The question remains, where is the body of Manny Salado?
Again, Exondia's web history offers investigators a promising lead.
They have some searches that she did. She has some maps that she was looking at. So they know that probably somewhere in eastern Oklahoma.
Did Exondia transport Manny's body to a rural area in the eastern part of the state? Detectives are hesitant to initiate a search in an area as expansive and rugged as eastern Oklahoma.
If you were to go out to the eastern part of Oklahoma County, where it's very rural and heavily wooded, it would be really easy to dispose of a body out there.
Given what they know about the volatile relationship between the couple, detectives believe Exondia had motive for wanting her husband dead.
For Exondia, getting a divorce would have been too easy. She would have lost in her mind, in her sick and twisted mind. She would have believed that she had really lost. She had to win, and she could not win with a divorce because she would have gotten nothing at all. All of her secrets would have been exposed. Everyone would have found out who the true Exondia really was. So she believes in her warped thinking that she had to actually exonerate herself by murdering Manny.
Without Manny's body, and with the red stains on Exondia's walls testing negative for blood or any other organic material, there is zero physical evidence tying Exondia to the crime. But then, the lab announces the findings of its DNA test on the mysterious stain in Exondia's van. Unlike the apartment, these stains come back positive for organic material, most likely human blood.
The coup de grace, or last straw, was a DNA in the floor of the van. That DNA resulted in a match with Manny Salado. It's ironic that we located the DNA inside the van underneath the seat, because early in the investigation, we had actually found a seat inside the apartment.
Detectives are ready to make an arrest, but there's just one problem. Ever since they asked Exondia to leave the scene so as not to interfere with their second search of her apartment and vehicle, she's been completely MIA.
We were suspicious of Exondia, but we had no proof to obtain custody of her. Her whereabouts was unknown at that time.
Investigators searched the country for clues to Exondia's whereabouts. Finally, in mid-December of 2008, over a year after Manny's disappearance, they receive a tip that Exondia is living and working in Florida.
Exondia was working at a telemarketing place. She came off kind of weird, maybe flashy, and it was just something about her that made her coworkers curious. Based on her behavior at work, they had actually Googled her name on the internet and actually found information in reference to the case back here in Oklahoma City. So they decided to call and let us know where she was.
Finally, on December 16th, 2008, law enforcement in Sanford, Florida arrest Exondia at a relative's home. She is charged with first-degree murder and is extradited back to Oklahoma City. Even from behind bars, Exondia denies any involvement in Manny's disappearance.
So you never told April or anybody else that you hurt him?
No.
Even if you were joking or playing or whatever, you never mentioned that you killed him? If you did, you know, we need to know.
I haven't told anybody anything.
Despite Exondia's denials, the state moves forward with the murder charges. And on March 22, 2011, nearly 3 years after her arrest, Exondia Salado walks into an Oklahoma County courtroom to stand trial for her husband's murder. With Manny's body never recovered, prosecutors know a guilty verdict against Exondia is far from a done deal.
In every other murder case that you have a body, you have a doctor that comes in and tells the jury, this is how this person died, and somebody had to have killed this person. And we didn't have that in this case.
Prosecutors opened their case by laying out what they feel was Exondia's motive for killing her husband, jealousy.
Manny had done the ultimate as far as Exondia was concerned. He'd gone off to another country, dated another woman, is in love with her, and is planning on leaving her. That's the ultimate level of embarrassment.
Exondia could have easily divorced Manny instead of going to such extremes to kill him. But it was almost as if she had an attitude that if I can't have you, then no one can.
And though police never found a handgun, and there's no proof Exondia ever purchased one, prosecutors lay out a detailed account of how they believe Manny was murdered, starting with the information they found on Exondia's home computer.
There were internet searches made prior to the time we believe Manny was killed that had to do with a gun.
According to prosecutors, the internet searches also suggest Exondia shot Manny in the chest, although it appears the bullet didn't kill him instantly.
The indication there for the jury was that he didn't die right away, that he was struggling to breathe, and she was looked up stuff on the internet to see how long it was going to take him to die.
She watches him finally die, and when he does, she wraps Manny in a sheet and stuffs him in the closet until she can figure out what to do.
According to prosecutors, that's when Exondia started trolling the internet again, this time looking for ways to cut up and cook her husband.
That was when the juror's eyes just got really big, when excerpts of that were read to him at trial.
The look on some of the jurors' face, they were just absolutely in shock.
To support their argument, prosecutors introduced the internet search history recovered from the Salado's home computer, as well as the corresponding pages for the items Exondia purchased at Home Depot. They also called Salado family friend April Stubbs to the witness stand.
April Stubbs testified. She came over to Salado's apartment and asked Miss Salado where Manny was, and she just very calmly said, "Manny's in the closet."
She thought that Exondia was being facetious, but then she started to put two and two together.
April Stubbs also recounts for jurors the day Exondia asked her to watch her daughter, only to return a few days later, covered in dirt and smelling like death.
During that time, she went to the Home Depot, bought all of the materials that she needed in order to cut up a body, and she had those things loaded into her car. And some kind of way, she goes out to the remote part of the county and barbecues him after cutting him up.
I think that those types of statements that Exondia made to April tell us really more about Exondia and how arrogant she was, that I think that she assumed April was her friend and not Manny's friend, and that April really only cared about Exondia and not Manny, which was completely false.
Exondia was just really testing the waters. What would April think? April was the best person to try this out on and tell this story too, and to see how April would take it. So if she knew how April would take it, then that gave her permission to be able to tell that same story to other people. But she also thought that she was just that bright, that she could actually get away with something like this. And if April didn't pay her any attention, then she believed that other people would not either.
To further support their case against Exondia, prosecutors point to the DNA evidence found in the couple's van.
That, I believe, showed traces of what a decomposing body would leave in a position like that.
While the DNA evidence seems convincing, Exondia's defense team argues it's hardly proof that a crime was committed.
They couldn't say exactly what kind of substance created the DNA. They couldn't say that it wasn't from sweat, anything like that. It's a van, so you have to take the seat out. What if he cuts his hand back there, or what if he's sweating back there?
Exondia's attorneys assert that not only is their client innocent of murdering Manny Salado, but that Manny is still very much alive.
The defense argued that Manny Salado had ran away with a woman he was having a relationship with in the Dominican Republic. He had eloped, and that he was in fact not dead.
The defense acknowledges this theory is largely speculation, but no more so than the prosecution's version of events.
Our whole defense was improbability. Nothing matched up. There was no evidence of any blood in the apartment at all. How could a 100-pound woman take a dead body down all those stairs, put him in the van? They never found the burn pit. They never found the body. All these apartments are close together. I interviewed numerous people from the apartment complex. Nobody heard anything. And those apartment complex residents said if they would have heard anything, they would have called police.
The defense would have the jury believe the evidence the state presented was not sufficient to show that Exondia Salado had actually killed Manny.
But before this case heads to the jury, two more witnesses will step forward and provide testimony that will determine whether Exondia Salado is bound for prison or will walk out of court a free woman. Exondia Salado is on trial for the murder of her 33-year-old husband, Manny. Prosecutors allege Exondia shot, dismembered, and then burned her husband's body in an unidentified location in eastern Oklahoma City.
Wives murder their husbands and husbands murder their wives, but the length that she went to plan it and then carry it through and then dismember him and then literally cook him until he was gone, it defies humanity.
The state has presented compelling evidence, including DNA found in the couple's car. They've also shown the jury Exondia's history of strange and often horrifying web searches.
There were a lot of searches that gave us the indication that she was trying to find out how to either dispose of or how to kill a human being.
But defense attorneys have argued that Manny abandoned his family to be with his new girlfriend in the Dominican Republic.
Our whole defense was that they couldn't prove that he had actually been murdered, that in fact he had motive to flee.
With momentum shifting in favor of the defense, the prosecution pulls their trump card, a surprise witness named Ricardo Del Rosario.
Ricardo Del Rosario was actually Manny's friend and had been a co-worker of Manny's.
The night he was murdered, he went to Ricardo's house and he was going to maybe stay the night there. Manny had expressed to Ricardo that he was afraid that his wife was going to kill him.
He didn't feel safe staying in the home any longer.
What do you mean she's trying to kill you?
Yeah, man, look. I woke up last night, man, and she was standing over top of me with a box cutter.
What?
He had a visit with Ricardo. It was interrupted by a call from Exondia. And he decided to go home.
She was able to lure him back in to her clutches and have him to come back home. And he was not seen again from that night on.
Ricardo was very concerned about Manny that night. He didn't want Manny to go home. And he just seemed very genuine in the way that he talked in front of the jury.
But Ricardo Del Rosario's testimony is just the beginning. Prosecutors also call another surprise witness, Exondia's lover from Chicago, Edgar Garcia.
He testified that Exondia told him about dismembering her husband's body and cooking it out in the country.
On the days when Exondia was disposing of Manny's body, she was actually carrying on phone conversations with her boyfriend in Chicago and relaying to him what she was doing.
Edgar's testimony is 180 degrees opposite from what he originally told police, which could have made him an accessory after the fact. But by coming clean, Edgar provides the most compelling testimony yet.
He ended up being one of the star witnesses in the case because it was clear by his in-court testimony that the plan was to kill Manny, and that was completely parallel with the computer forensic evidence.
Edgar Garcia's testimony is damaging, but as both sides rest, Exondia's defense team is still confident the jury will acquit.
They never found a body or a burn pit. How could you convict her without those things? All pretty much circumstantial evidence, absent the van and the DNA in the van. Mostly it's relying on her computer, her phone, and her statement to the individual in Chicago, her boyfriend, and April Stubbs.
3 hours later, the jury returns with their verdict.
Exondia was found guilty of first-degree murder.
This case was entirely based on circumstantial evidence. There was no body, and there was really no direct evidence to link Exondia to the crime. But the fact of the matter is, there was so much evidence, circumstantial or not, that it was enough to find that she was guilty.
The jury said that they gave Exondia life without parole so she could never, ever have custody of her daughter again. They wanted to protect her from her mother, and they did.
She's sitting over there, a very attractive woman, a very small woman, and you're just wondering, wow, how can this woman have done that? And she's very cold and very detached. Even when the jury comes back with their verdict, she's just nothing, flat.
Googling is one thing, but actually playing it out and doing it the way that you researched it for so many months that she did, I mean, she played it out and followed the instructions step by step by step. And if she wouldn't have said a word to April, she would probably be in society, which is scarier.
But even with Exondia behind bars, the Salados' friends and family can't help but wonder how the marriage of a couple, once head over heels in love, could disintegrate into a cycle of sexual betrayal, verbal abuse, and ultimately, murder.
I think this was a revenge killing. I think that she was truly hurt by the fact that Manny humiliated her. She would tell Manny, you embarrassed me. I believe the fact that he told people embarrassed her more than the actual act of cheating on her.
I forgive Exondia for what she had done. You know, I pray, still pray for her. I hope, you know, she get forgiven by God for what she had done. Otherwise, she just had to live with that.